For those of you who don't know me, I'm Mel Lindley. My background is as an academic in the physiotherapy subject group.
Hello.
And then the last 18 months I've been faculty for technology and advanced learning. So I want to talk to you with Nicky about our experience of changing our postgrad programme and how we came back to screencasting for assessment. Because it was the programme that I used to run, we revalidated together before I jumped ship and changed my role.
I'm Nicky. Snowdon, I'm one of the teachers in video focus, so I do most of my teaching at postgrad, so I'm now course lead for the course that Mel ran away from, which is this course, and I also lead the first module on this course, which is what we're talking about.
Just wanted to give a bit of context really before we sort of jump into sort of screencasting per se. The old postgrad physio programme, we used to have a number of different options whereby we had a course that was very much for experienced physiotherapists. There was another postgrad course that was very much aimed at newly qualified, and we also had an international cohort as well. So we had three different courses running, and we had to respond to market forces, didn't we? The change to postgraduate work visas, the change to NHS funding and access to postgrad opportunities meant that our market was changing. So we looked at redesigning a postgrad programme that allowed us to achieve what we wanted to achieve but deliver it in different ways. So we wrote a programme that had specific learning outcomes, but every module had a face-to-face version and a distance learning version. So they had the same learning outcomes, but their learning and teaching strategies and sometimes their assessment strategies were different, but ultimately they achieved the same learning outcomes. So a student can come out with the MSc in Advanced Physical Therapy Practice and either study it completely DL, completely face-to-face, or a mismatch of both. And that was quite new to our faculty. I don't know if the faculties in relation to previously distance learning programmes had to be validated separately. And there was a real challenge when we wrote it to try and break down some preconceptions in terms of, can you, in a very practical, perceived practical course, physiotherapy, do a whole master's distance learning? And the argument was, yes, it's about thinking and the application to practice rather than the hands-on skills which you develop as an undergrad. But I think it was a real challenge, wasn't it, to really sort of help our staff and our stakeholders transition to, you can still achieve the same thing distance learning if you can face-to-face in a practical profession. So we still wanted to develop clinical skills, therapeutic skills, reflective skills, and the way in which we achieve that in different areas, I think, was we looked at the module structure and had really clear, I think, a clear journey for the students from the beginning of each of the modules through to the dissertation at the end, so that they could build, develop their clinical reason skills, the application, bring in the theory, think about wider context, and then a little bit about change management and service improvement, which I've now got a few more resources and then obviously the project planning and management at the end. We also tried to have a bit more of a clear steer in terms of, yes, there are optional modules, but there were a lot less optional modules than there used to be, so that again there was a clearer progression for the students. So that was about it.
As module leader, my module is the first module that they do when they join the course, and it's basically about patient assessment. So in terms of content, it's about how you assess a patient, and in terms of skills, it's about their reflective abilities, so looking back at how they would normally assess a patient and thinking about ways in which they can improve that. Same learning outcomes across both deliveries. We have the deliveries fairly separate at the moment, so we have a face-to-face cohort and a distance learning cohort. They run at the same time, which is really hard work for a module leader, but they're two separate cohorts. So structured content, we do on this distance learning one, we do synchronous and asynchronous discussion using the discussion board, and also using things like Collaborate, and we have a number of formative activities. It's a very short and tight module, which you've sort of done deliberately in order to go, this is about getting your head into master's level study, and this is about reflecting upon what you do at the moment as a physiotherapist, and it sets you up for a lot of the rest of the course. So, So what we decided to do, we were sort of thinking about, it's an obvious one for a presentation on Viva. So it's about thinking about what you've taken a case to the patient, choosing a patient where you realise you could have done something better with them, and then saying, this is what I did well, this is what I could have done better. So present that, and then have a Viva with an individual tutor where you talk through what your main reflections are, how you managed to collaborate with that patient in order to come up with a solution together about how that person might improve whatever it is they've gone to the physio with. And we approached this by thinking, this is what we would do face to face, and therefore how do we sort of match that in a distance learning environment? And what we decided to do was that the students would basically do exactly the same thing. They would give a presentation and then they would have a Viva. But for the distance learning students, we'd separate those in time and space so that they recorded their presentation and then 4 days later they attended for a Viva. So obviously the person who's marking watches the presentation online and then does the Viva with them a little bit later.
Sorry, in terms of from the validation event when we validated the programme, the validation panel were quite nervous about a distance learning programme and they wanted to make sure that we weren't disadvantaging distance learning students. So one of the requirements was a robust evaluation post delivery for the first year to show that our distance learning students weren't being disadvantaged. And I think one of the concerns, one of the assessment strategies and the design that came about was for that module in particular, it's about articulating, as you say, that reflection. We were trying to look at a way of replicating that in that being too different. But yeah, that was kind of the context. So.
Yeah. I think that whole feeling of how are you going to make a distance learning as good as you face to face was what we were faced with. So what we said was, you're going to produce a presentation, it's going to be a standalone presentation, and you can do that in a number of different formats. So I gave them, I screencasted and talked them through some of the options, and then they simply got this text on the Blackboard site saying, the simplest thing you might want to do is produce a PowerPoint presentation and then record an audio file, upload both of those, you know, and that's what we mark. Or you could video yourself giving a presentation, or you could screencast it. So we gave them all of those different options so that we weren't forcing them down a technology route that they were uncomfortable with. But basically, they needed to do something that stood alone. And as you see on here, I put the final option is to produce a screencast. and then what we found was actually the majority of students chose that screencast. So you can see it's a very small cohort. So 7 students chose to record a screencast. 3 of them chose to produce to submit a PowerPoint with a separate audio file. One of them chose to go one step further in terms of technology and attach individual audio clips to each slide within the PowerPoint. And one of them, he actually is a university lecturer and he chose to use Articulate even though it wasn't on the list. It was just something that he was already using as a tutor. So students chose what they were familiar with, either because they'd used it before or because they were watching those presentations on the module all the time. And I think that's probably, you know, important to think to recognise that is that because I was using quite a bit of screencasts, so each folder would have 1 or 2 screencasts within it to introduce ideas. The module introduction was screencasted, the assessment was screencasted, so they'd sort of understood what we meant by that and had got the concept of a relatively short video clip of me giving a presentation. So I asked them afterwards why they chose what they chose, and they sort of said, you know, I could see what it was supposed to be because you'd shown us what it was supposed to be. One student wanted to give a screencast because they hadn't understood the technology behind it and they assumed that they'd need some sort of high-tech video camera in order to produce it, so they just didn't ever visit the web page to understand how to actually do that. But again, physiotherapists aren't known for their use of technology. So to actually have 7 of them go ahead and actually go, yes, I can do a screencast, I'll look into that, or indeed, yes, I'll do a PowerPoint and record an audio, I thought was actually quite encouraging if physios could do it. So most had no prior experience of screencasting, as I say. One used Articulate because it used it before in teaching, and one of our international students had used QuickTime before. When we asked them about how they got on with it afterwards, one student said, I just recorded it, I had one go, it didn't work, I had another go, and that worked. One student took 3 takes, lots of students took loads and loads and loads of takes. So they were using the free version of Screencast-O-Matic, where you can't actually make a mistake and then just bring it back and have another go. Basically, they had to get it right within that 10-minute block, and if they didn't get it right, if they fumbled over the words, they had to do it again. One of the main reasons that they said for multiple takes was the fact that we imposed 10 minutes. So Screencast-O-Matic free version does give you 15, and we haven't thought about whether we should change to that. But we gave them a 10-minute limit, which is quite tough for them.
Can I ask, would you change that? Do you think that, that there should be more opportunity for them just to have the one where they can do more high skill things with a screencast, stop it, pause it and do that?
I'm not sure in terms of reflecting on it, because actually you know how in your face to face you say to your students, practice your presentation.
Yeah.
Practice, you will practice your presentation, and then they come up and most of them clearly haven't actually practiced their presentation. It's one of the many things where we actually go, do you know, I think we've given them an advantage by giving them this, because it's sort of forced them to retake it, to do it again.
You're stealing the last slides, aren't you?
I don't apologise.
No, you're absolutely right, in terms of, and if they can edit it as well, because if we're assessing the face-to-face students standing up and presenting, you know, I mean,
they
we've been fumbling our words, you know, in terms of they can't, rewind. So there is a bit of an element of, if you gave them the editing version, does that overly advantage them compared to ones that just have to stand up and go for it?
Yeah, and so with the free version, you're sort of forcing them to, they're practicing as many times as they need before they're happy with that. And also they're seeing themselves the way that you're, exactly the same way as you're going to see them, which actually, when I'm given a presentation, I never really see that. So, yeah.
It's perfect. So next time in a validation panel, when it's in traditional delivery, how are you going to ensure that your on-campus students aren't disadvantaged compared to distance learning?
That's
what it sounds like.
We're not
going to
the next slide.
Oh, validation concern. I love that. Sorry.
That's the point.
Sorry,
we have nearly lunch.
I'm sorry.
this is similar sort of points, really. The students found it easy to set up and use. So again, there may be people in the room who haven't even used Screencast themselves yet. So I think to actually say to you, we gave it to the students, they just simply went to the free web page and they used it and they found it as easy, and easy from a technological point of view. One of our students, who's an experienced physio who works in the UK rural setting, is actually now using screencasting for their staff in service training. So they've actually gone, oh look, we work all over the place in different parts of North Yorkshire. If I can record a presentation and post it onto YouTube, my friends can see it, and then we can, it's actually made them go, oh, we could use this as a different approach for our own training as well. Things that they said about what they liked about it, they said they like to see the cursor moving on the slide. So, if you just have the PowerPoint presentation and someone talking over that, you don't always get that feeling of what they're talking about now, what they're thinking and where they're going with that. Whereas what you can do on a screencast is, I'm like underlining things, I'm putting a ring around things with a cursor. When I stop moving, that goes away. But whilst I'm actually moving the cursor, it draws someone's attention to the thing that I'm discussing on the slide. They did say that they worried more about the presentation than they would have done with a face-to-face presentation. And I think that is important for us to bear in mind. But there is still, that's a, there's pros and cons to that. Sometimes we quite like them to worry.
Well, yeah, I think that needs more picking in terms of, what do you mean by worry? Is it that you, is it the mode of delivery, or actually are you focusing on the assessment plus and what you're trying to articulate because it's a recording rather than just happening in a moment in time? I think there's a lot we could kind of unpick with there. I am sorry.
And as I'm sure most of us think of ourselves, it is quite hard to listen back to your own recorded voice. You sound very different as a recorded voice than you think you do when you're talking.
So have you done screencasts with most of you?
Yeah.
Have you listened to yourself back? Is it off-putting? Because I absolutely...
Frightening, I would
say.
Get alive,
it's really bizarre, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think it really does fit with that whole thing about putting going into one another's shoes, which fits very much in the sort of things that David was saying earlier.
Yeah.
You know, the students, it's part of the students seeing themselves like we see ourselves and us seeing ourselves like they see themselves. It's, you know, we're sharing the same, we're doing the same things. And I think the screencasting actually made that a little bit more obvious than just the stand up in front of me.
Yeah. I think the other thing, I don't know about how professional your screencasts are, but mine are usually fraught with falling over, you know, my own teeth or, you know, laughing at something I've mispronounced, and I don't go back and edit out all of those. So again, I think it allows students to appreciate that it doesn't have to be pitch perfect as well, because we certainly aren't, and that kind of human element comes through by the fact that we're using it in our teaching and getting ready to use it as well.
Yeah.
And that's quite nice.
But then we do the same thing in face-to-face, so I wonder why the students don't think that they... I'll move on from that. So, from the point of view of as a member of staff marking this, it was also really nice. So it meant that I could listen to it once, or actually, if they put a big table on there, I could pause the student. You can never pause a student in a face-to-face presentation, can you? And it meant that I could go, now stop, I need to write some notes about what questions I want to ask there, or stop, and then they've put some really good points on that slide. So, you know, I don't want to go over the top and make you worry about the face-to-face more. But then that made me stop and think, oh, I can't do that in a face-to-face presentation. And then we're going back to doing the face-to-face ones and going, gosh, I wish I could pause you. I wish I could write better notes about what it is you're doing at this point that I think is really good, or what it is I'm doing that you're doing at this point that I want to make some sort of comments or improvement. Can't do that.
Could you not ask face-to-face students to do a screencast?
Well, absolutely. We haven't done that this year. We haven't chosen to do that.
It's a big learning exercise.
Excellent, yeah, absolutely.
Do that.
Yes.
Then everybody is doing the same thing.
Everyone's doing something, yeah, indeed. I think we haven't chosen to do that this time round, but I do think it needs discussing. I think it's something that we saw so many advantages to it that I think it is a logical step forward.
I think the thing is that, I mean, from my own experience of doing presentations and trying to even talk them out beforehand, there's something difficult about doing that. I don't know why it is difficult, because you know it would make a big improvement, but you just can't get yourself to do it. So it would seem like it's quite a good thing to probably to do, because as you say, you do, I mean, to see yourself doing the talk is kind of quite interesting. So it does give you insight into what you can improve on.
So just in terms of practicalities, we just wanted to say the various formats were equally easy to watch and mark. So we wouldn't particularly force someone to use screencasting rather than the sort of slightly less high-tech options. They were all easy for them to use and easy for us to watch and mark. And one of our things that we were worried about was file size and whether they would be easy to submit over Blackboard, and they were absolutely fine. The largest file size was the QuickTime one, and all the other screencasts were 19 to 23 megabytes, which is actually feels like not an awful lot nowadays. And I'm sorry to have to say that also the DL students actually did better, and that is potentially, this is probably not just because of the format of the presentation, I'm sure it isn't. But both cohorts had some internationally trained physiotherapists and some UK trained physiotherapists. Looking at those, we've not split those two groups up separately on this slide, but the international students did just as well DL as face-to-face, they were the same. The UK students actually did slightly better by around about sort of 5% average on the distance learning version than they did on the face-to-face version. The different students that have chosen distance learning for a reason, so it's not necessarily because of just the format of the presentation. But again, I think it just means, you know, there is no worry about is distance learning worse, we all know.
And if I'm honest, it's slightly naughty, because if you take into IMR, that goes up to 94%. Did have, because it was the first module of the programme, they did have in module retrieval. So the face-to-face students did get up to an equivalent first-time pass in terms of marks going through board. But that was just the kind of
issues. I wonder if it was about time on task. Because
yeah.
The screencasting
yes.
seems to encourage this time on
yeah.
task.
Yeah.
And I just wonder whether actually that's quite good evidence of that. Because IMR is just an opportunity to spend more time on the task.
Right. You also get a chance to self-correct.
Yeah.
Well, that's what you're describing. You're
absolutely.
Yeah.
Right? The feedback I got from the face-to-face module was from the students who did the IMR, who didn't get through first time and needed IMR. And bless them, they were saying things like, "I'm so glad I failed first time." Because when they were getting then into semester two, they were saying, "I'm having to teach my friends about reflection because my friends still haven't really got it because they almost by luck passed this module first time around. Because I didn't pass it first time around, I had to reflect much more fully, and therefore I understand more what you mean by reflection."
Opportunities
to respond to that feedback and actually show how they respond to that
feedback. Well, they've really, really done everything. They've created their own feedback and responded to it. And they for that.
So there we go.
Sorry, Bob.
With that comparison, the DL students, they have only one slot time to record, or they can do record as
many times. So they have to submit that final file.
Yeah.
But they can record themselves several times and then submit one time.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually.
It's fair when you compare these two groups together.
That's exactly what we mean, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's better quality, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
I suppose if they're doing a face-to-face, they will do a little bit of practice. It might not be as many.
That's the issue.
I think there is an issue there.
So what I would do on the face-to-face is say, you should practice your presentation. Do it to one another.
Yeah,
practice
yeah,
to
that,
one another.
That's the thing, isn't it, in terms of it's that peer feedback, I think.
Yeah.
And it's getting them to present to their group and getting some feedback.
Yeah.
So you've got someone in the audience, as you say, it's very hard if you just present coal to an empty room. It's that thing that we need to try and build in a little bit more, just to try and get a little bit more equity, if we or give people the option to do their own screencast and listen to it, and then they can choose whether they do a face-to-face or a screencast. I think there's lots of opportunity for people to choose their delivery method potentially.
If we consider a time slot for last recording online, I think it gets a better equality between two groups. For example, at Wednesday between 10:30 to, for example, 10:40, this is the record that you have due. And so, I don't know, they have not any other chance to repeat it again. They have to make themselves ready at that slot.
Yes,
but why
is that different to just having a submission deadline? Because we say 4 p.m. on such and such, they've got to, they could record it any time between that. Why is adding a time pressure? Is it just the extra anxiety that people would get from standing face to face? And is that fair? In terms of, is that part of the learning outcomes? Because if you think about the learning outcomes for the module, adding in time pressure and anxiety is not an outcome for the module, if you see what I mean. So, but if there is a disadvantage for people doing it face-to-face, we need to address that. So it's less about making it worse for the DL students and how do you make it better for the face-to-face, possibly. But I agree with what you're saying in terms of there is something about the lack of pressure if you can do it whenever.
They both have the option, don't they, of doing it once, or of doing it
lots of times beforehand.
Yeah.
But it's much more difficult to submit something that's going to be recorded and permanent that isn't practiced than it is to stand up in front of a group and just talk. So they both have those options. It's just for distance learners, it's much more difficult to take I'll just do it this once. And
but it's interesting that the perception you've kind of articulated as well, in terms of, because it's submitted and it's there and it's recording, you've kind of implied greater engagement rather than the importance of standing up and, because it's a snapshot in time, do people put less importance on it, or because it's not recorded, do you feel
it's
less...
It's fleeting, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's not fleeting,
yes, absolutely.
Late to remind you
how terribly
you've been. I've seen a few of my screencasts and re-recorded them.
yeah.
But what does that say about students thinking about then the assessment task itself, you know, in terms of just by the different medium used, but people putting different importance on the task and the content and the quality of the task? I think that's
I mean, I think the thing is that there's a lot of discussion about whether it's fair or not. And then there's fair is a strange concept. And then, you know, for the final assessment, what I can see in this is 100 ways to make it better, which is things like, hundreds of possibilities in terms of, you know, if you want the people who are doing the face to face to do it better, you could give them screencasts from people in previous years and say, have a look at these and see how well they've done it.
Yeah.
Or, you know, if you want the screencast people to do it better, you could get them to, you know, produce a screencast and share it with each other and then ask them to update it. You know, I mean, if you focus on the learning, there's lots of ways that you could, you know, do, as I said today, look at two screencasts. Why is this? Pick one that you think is very good, or do give them one of yours. And ask them to compare that with a couple of others and say which one is the best and why, you know.
Then
do your own.
Yeah.
We're running out of time.
Well, basically, we've talked about everything. Pardon?
What you said.
Yeah. All right.
According to
we've covered everything on the one slide. We've already talked about it, certainly.
Is that one of your students?
But thank you for your input and certainly your considerations, and I might come back to you on some of the that's great. Just a bit of a plug, the assessment journey guys that are next door, for any of you who haven't done screencasting before, there are some laptops out with headsets and the ability to go and play and actually do your own screencast and just have it in if you've not done one before, if you're interested. So that's it. Okay.
Thank you.